Atoms are normally described as the smallest unit of an element that still behaves like that element. So a single atom of nickel is still nickel, indeed in its purest possible form. Same with gold, hydrogen, iron, uranium, and so on. These elements make up all the normal matter around us, and we ourselves are made from them. But we know that there are loopholes, and it's possible, at least hypothetically, to make atoms that are not as we normally know them, with their nuclei and electrons. And we know that something like this exists in the form of dark matter, which is not made up of normal matter but something else, and that something remains a mystery. There has been some talk that dark matter may actually be extremely complicated, in the same way that normal matter is, and that there could lie within the subject an entire dark periodic table, where elements of dark matter exist, combining perhaps into molecules, and so on, but only interacting with us through gravity. The sky is the limit there. If it is indeed the case, which no one knows, there could be an entire dark world hovering right above us, an alternative universe that could even have things like dark matter aliens occupying the same space we are, or not. Open questions regarding dark matter are the prevalence of primordial black holes, and if they still exist, whether dark matter is a neutrino-like non-interactive particle, and so on. Perhaps the best candidate is the particle, because, well, we know neutrinos exist, and in some ways act like dark matter, but can't be because there isn't enough of them to account for all the gravity. Speculation about dark matter aside, there are also hypothesized exotic forms of regular matter, made up of the same subatomic particles that we're familiar with. And within that is the idea of exotic atoms made of configurations of particles not normally seen in nature. Fundamentally, subatomic particles in atoms can actually be replaced. In a normal atom, the negatively charged electron can actually be replaced with another particle with the same negative charge, such as muons and pions. The problem is that this is usually not very stable, so when it's done, it doesn't last long before decaying. The first class of exotic atom is the muonic atom. As mentioned, this is where the electron is replaced with a muon. Muons, like electrons, are leptons. These in turn react with the electromagnetic force, which means that muonic atoms are governed by it. But here's where things get weird. The muon is more massive than the electron, like 207 times more massive. And as a result, its Bohr orbit is closer to the nucleus than would be in a normally configured atom. This actually is useful in studying things like quantum electrodynamics, but even more so in the pursuit of fusion energy. So with fusion, there is a process known as muon-catalyzed fusion that holds huge potential, so long as we can actually make it practical. So the main benefit of this type of fusion is that it can occur at temperatures much lower than the insane temperatures needed for normal fusion, even at room temperature. So the idea is this: you take hydrogen and make it into a muonic atom by switching out the electron with a muon. The muon is drawn far closer, 186 times closer to the nucleus than an electron would be. Putting that hydrogen into a muonic hydrogen molecule of two atoms of muonic hydrogen and the nuclei of the two atoms are much, much closer than normal, which greatly increases the probability of fusion occurring to the point that it happens at room temperature. The problem is that muons are rather hard to obtain, meaning that it's not even close to break even, because so much energy is required to get the muons in the first place. And muons being unstable aren't storable for very long. So the only way this kind of fusion will happen is if we ever find a cheap way to create muonic hydrogen atoms. Muonic helium and many other types of muonic atoms can also be envisioned. The next type of exotic atom are hadronic atoms that work much the same, except instead of a muon replacing the electron, it's a negatively charged hadron. There are several types of this, such as pionic atoms and kaonic atoms. Kaonic atoms in particular have been known to exist since 1997. Basically, you take a proton and a kaon, collide them at low energy in a hydrogen gas target, and you get kaonic hydrogen. But again, this situation is unstable, but useful in testing quantum chromodynamics and strong force interactions. The next class is really exotic. These are termed uniums, and they consist of a particle and its antiparticle in a bound state, which turns out to be metastable, even though it's matter and antimatter interaction. They just aren't coming together. There are a few of these. Pionium consists of two oppositely charged pions. Protonium is a proton and an antiproton, and so on. Yet another type are hypernuclear atoms, which include a particle called a hyperon, which are baryons that contain strange quarks but no charm bottom or top quarks. This type of exotic atom finds uses in studying nuclear physics. There are also atom models that incorporate quasiparticles, which are useful in semiconductor research, and even molecules of exotic atoms are possible. Two of these would be positronium hydride, which is an atom of positronium bound with a hydrogen atom, and dipositronium, which are two positronium exotic atoms bound together in a molecule. So in the end, nature actually allows for atoms outside of how we normally think of them. But recent work has shown that normal atoms can also behave in a very exotic manner, and one of them being actively studied are atoms existing at an impossible temperature, colder than absolute zero, if it can be termed that way. This is strange stuff. Conventional wisdom is that the coldest possible temperature in the universe is absolute zero. This is the lowest limit, or temperature, in the sense that it is atoms standing as still as they possibly can, which happens at zero Kelvin, or negative 273.15 Celsius, or negative 459.67 degrees Fahrenheit. I stress as still as they possibly can, because quantum mechanical effects and zero-point energy can still cause movement. So it's their minimum vibrational motion. That's ultimately what cold is, the absence of heat. But it is possible to get colder than that. As it turns out, yes, at least in a way. And it paradoxically ends up in another sense, extremely hot. This actually involves a strange quantum state of matter. Researchers at Cambridge took atoms of potassium and were able to induce this state by manipulating both their energy levels and quantum states such that they actually went below absolute zero in behavior. So warm atoms are moving quickly, with lots of kinetic energy. But without that, and the atoms are more still, then they are at absolute zero. And that holds for normal thermodynamics. You can't go below this in that framework. But that's not the only way to measure temperature. You can also do it based on how energy is distributed across a number of atoms, something related to that system's entropy. So in this system of potassium atoms, if they have a temperature, they're all moving, but each atom at a different energy. When you get to absolute zero, they all have the same minimal energy, but going below that, it flips around, and the distribution goes the other way, meaning that you end up with more higher energy atoms than lower energy ones. And that's where it gets weird. That actually makes the negative temperatures hotter, meaning more energy, than their positive counterparts. So it's both the coldest and hottest possible in this experiment. How it was done was the researchers cooled the potassium atoms to near absolute zero and then employed lasers and magnetic fields in a vacuum to drop it further and induce control on the quantum states and energy levels of the individual atoms, resulting in a lower than absolute zero temperature. They also arranged the atoms into hexagons and triangles, known as a Kagome lattice. This results in all movement in the system coming from interactions and no kinetic energy at all. The big mystery here is what actually results, what kind of exotic quantum form of matter comes out of this, and that remains currently unknown. What its properties are, how that varies between different elements and so on are all open questions for future experiments and researchers. But there are some possibilities. Part of understanding this involves the Kagome lattice itself, because all kinds of quantum behaviors can result from that arrangement that are not well understood. One possibility is they might form something like a superfluid, but not. A superfluid has zero viscosity. Indeed, superfluid helium, for example, will climb the walls of beakers because of no viscosity, seemingly defying gravity. But here there should be no kinetic energy at all, and the sub-absolute zero matter shouldn't flow at all. But that's not absolutely certain. It may still go into a superfluid-like state, or some other state that we haven't ever seen. The idea of exotic atoms and normal atoms at impossible temperatures, or some future fusion of both, shows that even matter itself still holds surprises for science, and that there may be materials possible that we are still unaware of that could have extremely important properties that might be useful in scientific research and potentially even technology. The problem is, of course, that none of these arrangements are easy and cheap to do. They all require energy and conditions that aren't going to lend themselves very well to everyday technological use. But it also pays to remember that we don't know the future, and there was a time, not that long ago, just under 200 years, where we had absolutely no idea that aluminum existed. Once we found out how to smelt it out of ore, it had only limited use. Indeed, aluminum for a time was a metal used in tableware for the very rich because of its new and exotic nature. Now we make beverage cans out of it, automobile frames, aircraft, spacecraft, and all manner of things out of a material that was once exotic, and before then, completely unknown. Maybe hidden within future science there will be other such materials that eventually become as ubiquitous as a Pepsi can that we, primitive as we are, have no idea is even possible. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently musing about the periodic table. Yes, it's one of the most useful framework tools science has ever come up with. But at the same time, we now have atoms that aren't on it. I wonder if in the future anyone will ever create an exotic periodic table to accompany it. Food for thought. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.